We've got a full agenda of business this morning, so we'll get on and progress it. Do any members have a declaration of interest? Sorry, Rona, apologies first.
Thank you, Leader. We have apologies from Councillors Carruthers, Diggle, Marshall and Smith. And as we start the meeting, Councillor McGregor's not present.
Okay, I have two declarations of interest, members. No? Okay, can we turn to item three, the minute of the meeting of the 15th of September? Understand there's a suggested change to the minute, Rona. Can you make members aware of this?
Yes, thank you, Leader. Councillor McClung raised a query with the minute in regard to the decision on Kirkcudbright Art Gallery at item 16. In checking the recording, Councillor McClung is quite correct and that he did wish his dissent to be recorded. Accordingly, the minute will be changed to read that in item 16.1 that Councillor McClung wished his dissent to be recorded on the minute in regard to his objection that £120,000 contingency allowance allocated to the next generation broadband within the capital programme be used as a contribution towards the £199,000 for Kirkcudbright Art Gallery. Is that okay, Councillor McClung? Are you agreeable to that?
Yeah, that was exactly my objection.
Okay, subject to that amendment at 16.1, I'll approve.
Sorry, Chair, just a point of clarification. Can we be clear? I thought there was a change in how you could record your dissent. I'm presuming that's been taken into consideration.
Yeah, I think this complies with that, because I think if you put forward a motion, even if you don't get a seconder, I think you can record your dissent. Okay, with that second amendment, I'll approve.
Second.
Moving on to item four, this report gives members an overview of the Council's revenue budget and forecast financial performance for the year to the 31st of March 2017. The report provides a summary of forecast expenditure for the Council up to the end of September 2016 and the measures being taken to manage budgets across service. It also provides a forecast of year-end general fund balances and funding available to support investment and required savings through the change fund. The report also updates on progress on delivery of the agreed savings, and officers have continued to highlight the challenges and risks associated with the unprecedented level of savings we have to achieve this year and the potential impact and mitigation of these. All measures are being taken to ensure a budget position is balanced for 2016-17. However, we all know that next month the Scottish Government will publish their budget, and due to the priority being placed on other services and the reluctance of the Government to use the tax varying powers the Scottish Parliament now has, we need to prepare ourselves for funding cuts again this year. Paul Garrett is here to answer any questions arising from the report. I'll open up the meeting to members. Jill?
Thank you, Leader. Just on your comments about further cuts coming down the line, I believe there was a COSLA meeting, and I understand that there might have been some information put forward. I mean, obviously, we're expecting a much greater cut to our budget than we had anticipated, and I just wondered if Paul had any information on that.
Right. Before I bring Paul in, I think that, you know, it's the information that we're getting is it's not going to be any better than what we had before, and it won't be worse, and it could be up to £25 million instead of £21 million worth of cuts. But Paul?
Just to echo what the Leader says, it's absolutely consistent with that, and to be fair, that's consistent with what the position has been for the last couple of months and what's reflected in the briefing note that was issued to members in October. It's also reflected that item 6 on today's agenda, the indications are that the settlement would be at least as bad as last year, and the figures that the Leader has mentioned there is in the region of what we're looking at the minute.
Thanks, Leader. At 3.3,
It's a reference to an update to the EEI committee. Is there anything that's not in the papers that members who are not in EEI should maybe be aware of?
No, I think the only thing is to say that the position for EEI was discussed in detail at the committee last week. The management team set out an action plan in summary form in those papers in terms of some of the measures they'll be taking to now and the end of the year to seek to ensure delivery of a balanced budget. But that's really the overall updated position there.
I think part of that, Andy, is the uncertainty of, you know, where we are. And part of the uncertainty, I think, you know, the Scottish Government is looking at the planning fees, and there may be changes in that which may be helpful. So, you know, but we don't know. We can't, you know, look at that without a decision. Jane?
Thanks. I'll ask the question at a later date.
Jeff?
Yeah, one item which did come out at the EEI was that the free school meals for P2 to P3 has actually been locally underfunded. We received funding to deliver 75% anticipated. In actual fact, and all credit to the council, we're delivering 89%. So any weight you can bring to bear on the Scottish Government would be very useful.
Okay, with that, sorry. Stephen?
I'll try not to make a habit of coming in at the end there. It's just on page 17, there's three points really. Page 17, it references reducing payments to children and families for subsistence and travel. And in the narrative or comments, it's saying that the current pressure in this area has deteriorated from the last monitoring position. It may be helpful to get a wee update on that. Similarly, page 20, the energy efficiency. We seem to really be struggling with this because this comes up at every meeting just about, yet it doesn't seem to get any further forward. And again, it's noting that there's a risk that the saving won't be delivered in full. And similarly, page 24, with reference to GIRFEC. I'll just find it. So again, recruitment issues, the project underspends in the early stages, and it's gone on for longer than anticipated. So is there a reason why these particular ones seem to keep dragging? Because clearly they're not hitting the target.
In relation to the deterioration of the children and families placement, Stephen, last the morning report we'd had that would be a shortfall of 30,000. We're now recording that as a full non-delivery, so the saving will be not achieved in full, and that's due to a number of increased payments going out in relation to section payments for children and families, which is resulting in an overspend in that area within the social work budget. In relation to the energy efficiency measures, we're anticipating the report to PEEI committee earlier last week noted that there would be a report to that committee in January detailing the progress on the energy efficiency measures and what other schemes they're introducing at the moment. In relation to the last point in the GIRFEC and the policy development tracker, that is in relation to funding that's been carried forward from previous years. So it's because there's been an ongoing delay earlier in the process, the last financial year, this is them utilising the money in line with that requirement. So it's as a result of that delay. So the money is still being utilised in the way in which it was intended, just in a slight delayed mechanism.
Okay, with that, can we go to the recommendation? Sorry, Graham. Graham Park.
It was me, sorry. I'm just looking at 3.16, and it's to do with the change fund and things. And I don't quite understand an allowance for non-delivery of agreed savings and how you come to that amount of money. I mean, is it accurate, or is it a sort of projected guesstimate here?
At the bottom of the appendix on page, there's a table at the top of page 15, And at the bottom of there, it says it attempts to provide an analysis on the savings currently assessed as having a greater risk of non-delivery. And the figures shown are based on current monitoring information, and they do not reflect the worst-case scenario. They're actually based on a risk-assessed shortfall of probably the mid-range scenario in most cases. And officers are currently working, you know, to try and minimise that. So that it's not the worst-case scenario, but it is based on what we assess as the likely shortfall at the moment if no further progress is made.
So what would be the worst-case scenario?
I think that there is further risks on a number of the savings. I wouldn't like to necessarily put a figure on the worst case scenario. What I would say is that figure is what I would call a prudent figure. We'd expect to see an improvement against that between now and the end of the year to allow us to ensure that the level of funding and the change fund is at a reasonable level at the end of the year. So I would say, while not the worst case, it's prudent, and we'd like to see an improvement and hope to see an improvement in that between now and the end of the year.
Yeah, thanks, Chair. Under 3.3, overspend of £452,000 in EEI, and its planning fees, and I understand that, and building warrants being lower, and ongoing pressures within the pool car fleet budget. How come we've got ongoing pressures within that budget? We know how many pool cars we've got. We know how many miles they do. Surely that should have been all taken. There shouldn't be pressures in the fleet car, the pool car budget, because I understand that the pool cars are maybe needing to be a little more efficiently run, that a lot of them are sitting about too much and they should be being more efficiently utilised. But how come we've got pressures on that particular budget?
The pressures that are being experienced in there are in relation to some aspects of previous prior year savings, which they're still working to address, and a number of them are in relation to the contract elements. I think they've made significant improvements towards it this year, but there's still a bit that they're still needing to work towards. And I think the full year impact should be addressed next year of the prior year ones.
Okay. Yep, Jim.
Thanks, Leader. In 3.7, it states that an initial review has indicated the financial impact of inflation in 16-17 is likely to be limited. Is that currently the view?
Yeah, that is still the case. Inflation, obviously, there's been indications for the last couple of months of an increase. We've looked at how that impacts specifically on what government expenditure, council's own expenditure, and the impact in the current year is very limited. However, I think it's likely to be a greater issue going forward over a full year in 2017-18, we're starting to see some pressure in a couple of areas. Things like clothing and fuel are starting to see some increased costs. We're looking at projections for this time next year for inflation to inform the budget report that we'll bring to full council in December. But in terms of this report in 16-17, we think that the impact of inflation is limited.
Okay. Go to the recommendations. Can we know 1, 2 and 3? Yep. Moving on to item 5. This report provides a third update on progress of the agreed budget savings in relation to staff cost savings. Members will recall that we agreed a range of general savings which related directly to staff costs. A number of other savings clearly also had implications for staffing in specific terms of our services, and these were highlighted in the budget savings template we considered and agreed. The activity undertaken in the last 5 months to enable these considerable and very challenging savings are included in the report. In particular, the progression of a managed headcount reduction through our existing policies. At our last meeting, we asked for further information on contact with staff who had expressed an interest and more information on roles and staff groups where ERVS interest remained. Information on this is included in paragraphs 3.4 and 3.8 of the report. Paul's here to answer any questions. Members? Stephen?
Thank you. Right, I'll get them all in just now. A couple of questions. One's just a clarification on the Appendix 2, Table 4, shows a breakdown of level of interest. Sorry, I beg your pardon. It's Appendix 1, Table 2, page 33 of 684. And I'm just presuming that the last column there, which seems to be copied from the table above, should actually reflect those that are ongoing live cases rather than ongoing live and approved. So I think the numbers are maybe not quite right there. I think it should be 62, 33, 37, 28, 134, and it should total 294, which would correspond with earlier in the report when it's outlining the... Is that correct? For first off?
Leader, the difference between the two is that the live cases are shown in the second table, and the first one is live and approved to reflect the table that was in the September report, so that members had a like for like there. So essentially the numbers in table one include the 210 and the ones at the bottom exclude that.
Yeah, so the way I'm looking at it then, the last column on table two at the bottom should actually show those that aren't approved, if you like. So it's the remaining ones, is that correct?
So that should be two. That's correct.
Thank you. Okay, well, with that then, that clarifies that. In terms of the 3.9 and 3.10, where it's about the staff savings target, I'm just seeking a wee bit of clarity. Between the two paragraphs there, it's talking about, in 3.10, 409K has been achieved, and that's split between 200K and 209K against the staff cost savings template. But in the paragraph before, I'm a wee bit confused as to the 2.2 million and the 1.7 million, and I'm just wanting a wee bit of better breakdown of how much has been allocated to the alternative savings in terms of staff costs.
Leader, the savings in 3.9 reflect all the savings under ERVS for various service reviews, including the staff savings template, whereas the numbers in 3.10 reflect the staff savings allocation only, in that there's 409K against that, with the balance of the 2.2 million being against other staff savings.
And is it possible to get maybe a wee bit more detail on what the other savings would constitute in terms of, given that we've got some savings achieved already, what that remaining breakdown would come from? And just on that as well, the tables that show the level of interest, which is a helpful breakdown in terms of whether it's gender, directorate, etc. But there's still no, it doesn't actually tell me that in this directorate, this is the amount in this band that have opted for it, or this is the amount of females in this directorate of this age. So there's very little to cross-reference it, if you see what I mean. So although it looks at each metric individually, it doesn't actually tie them together. I'm just wondering if that additional information could be provided at a later date.
Certainly table four shows the directorates against the bandings. The previous table was the gender and age breakdown, and we can certainly break that down by service.
Andy?
Thanks, Leader. I'm interested in the table at 3.8, and I noticed that IGB have got down here for having 33 members of staff. I hope I'm right in saying that's 33 members of the council who actually carry out roles for the IGB as opposed to being employed by the IGB.
Absolutely.
Thanks. So can I come back in, Ronnie? Thanks. Whilst that's helpful, kind of misleading for members of the public would think the IGB actually have 33 members of staff. So I'm assuming those staff actually should be in the SIPL column if we're looking at department and department.
We actually split that out and for this report to give an indication of what the split was, because obviously there's more complexity over the release of staff within the IGB that's covered by the IGB. So we did that to just helpfully break those figures out for members.
Thanks very much, Paul. But is it not complex? Doesn't matter where the staff are, they're still our staff. And I appreciate there's management issues within the IGB and policy issues, and that's their domain, and the delivery of targets is their domain. But the management of the staff is very clearly the council's. And as I say, it would have been good. It's good it's there, right, because it gives us an idea. Right, but it would have been helpful if we could have made sure the public were aware that they weren't employed by the IGB, they were continuing employment within the council, just fulfilling a role for the IGB.
Leader, happy to also put it back in CYPLL if members would prefer it to be presented that way, but it was there as an indication.
Jane.
Leader, hello. You won't be entirely surprised to know that I'm coming back to what I started about last policy and resources, which is the issue of 3.13. And I can preface my remarks by saying that this is against the background of what we have just decided and discussed in the previous report, which is that we have failed to make the necessary savings, or look as if we are, to the tune of 1.446 million. And every pound that we don't make makes life more difficult for us on a cumulative rolling forward programme. And I think we've got to actually say that this particular savings requirement of the thick end of half a million, which is not going to be achieved, anything like it, I think we need to dig deeper and find out what exactly is happening. The public's about to be asked to make sacrifices and to pay more for services, and I fail to understand why it's not a reasonable thing to ask in exchange for a no compulsory redundancy policy, which we have, which we've all agreed is to be the case now, that I don't think it's unreasonable that we should push forward the proposals that are set out in 3.13. And so, Leader, I would like to ask you to agree to receive a report on these particular issues. I think we'd like to know, we'd like to have some light thrown on where exactly are the problems. We'd like to know whether they are in particular services. Are they indeed in particular localities? I think it would be useful for us and the public to know this, and to know this quickly, because, as I say, next year is just going to be more difficult. You've said that yourself. So I would like to see this actually explored and made open and obvious for us and for the public. Thank you.
Weider, the monitoring report's currently showing an achievement of 378,000, which is significant towards the total of 453. I think it's only fair at this stage to point out that there are certain challenges and those should not come as a surprise towards the end of the financial year as we start to find that difference. We are working to actually try to close that gap on both the ERVS and on overtime and all the others where we're showing signs that we won't at this stage make it. So happy to provide again more detail, but be assured that we're actually trying to work the numbers to make sure that we achieve the saving that's required.
Do I take it then that we will get that information? That would be very helpful.
Give me that forward, Paul. You provide that information?
Yes, okay. Yes, indeed.
Stephen?
Thanks again. It's just on that point. I mean, looking at that, it would seem that the saving in full is predicated on a change in terms and conditions, which obviously would be something that would have to be agreed, as opposed to just a reduction in overtime. But I wonder if that difference, or the balance of saving, if you like, could actually be achieved by just increasing the reduction in overtime by a few percent, rather than trying to negotiate a change in terms and conditions. And I'm just wondering what that level of change in the percentage overtime would be that would correspond to offset that time in a third negotiation, because I don't think the appetite for change in terms and conditions is high, given the delay to this particular saving. So is that possible, or could that be included in the report that you bring back?
We're not negotiating in terms and conditions. As far as I'm aware, there was talking about it, and it was made plain that, the terms and conditions weren't part of that. I think the basic thing about the overtime, and I think if we, without going into too much detail, it may be a very small percentage that people that's actually causing overtime. And this has been dealt with through systems within the council. And I think it has been dealt with on an ongoing basis.
We've actually taken previous savings out of overtime in previous years, and we're using the same methodologies as far as looking for essential areas where we require cover, where overtime is operationally a good idea, but clearly looking for where the bulk of overtime is and where we can take that out sensibly to achieve it. And the leader, you're absolutely right in terms of the TNCs. That was looked at. We discussed that with the trade unions. It was out with the mandate to go any further with that, and therefore we're looking for the managed head, reduction in the overtime itself to achieve it.
Yeah. Jim?
Yeah, thanks, leader. I'm happy to hear that the changes in terms and conditions are no longer being considered, but that was what was actually on the template. When you actually go and look at the template, it was a proposition to change the terms and conditions. I'll leave that one for now. 3.10 says there's a potential shortfall of 750k. You go to 3.13, you're forecasting a shortfall of 75k. 3.14, you're forecasting a shortfall of 150k. That leaves 525k unexplained. Where's the shortfall of the 525k?
We've got a monitor on all of these, and we're working toward the achievement of all. I mean, some of them are proving more challenging than others because staff have got to voluntarily elect into this before we can actually pursue any savings. And it may be that we pull in some additional funds from other heads that can allow that some of that to be offset. But clearly the position there in terms of the monitor is as stated in the paragraphs.
Jim?
Yeah, thanks for letting me back in. I realise that there will be ways that we can save money elsewhere, but at the end of the day, we're saying in 3.10 that the potential shortfall is 750, yet there is only 225k of that actually explained in the report.
It's actually just different templates, and we're running monitors on all these templates to show members what the illustration is against the savings required in each template.
Andy?
Thanks, leader. I'm back to the overtime question. I'm just wondering what the level of regular overtime is involved here, and therefore could be challenged if we try to stop it, because it's been going on for some significant period of time, and effectively could already be contractual. I'm just wondering if Paul can give us a breakdown on that type of overtime.
There's not a massive amount of contractual overtime. In fact, very, very limited amounts of contractual overtime, but there is regular overtimes, and part of when we review where we can actually take some funds from or reduce, we'll obviously have to bear that in mind. But there's not a big contractual entitlement to overtime currently.
Okay, thanks, leader. I think my question, Paulo, is there a significant amount of overtime that could be challengeable in that the staff have been receiving that on a regular basis for a number of years, and therefore could be argued it was contractual rather than an ad hoc arrangement?
We'll be mindful to that, but actually sometimes some of the larger amounts is more ad hoc rather than just overtime that's in the system. But we'll be mindful to that as we work through this.
Okay, can we go to the recommendations? Can we vote one and agree two? Thank you. Move on to item six, which is the financial strategy update and budget process. Members will recall that as part of our agreed budget process, we moved to a process of implementation, monitoring, and update of our agreed 3-year plan. In line with that process, this report provides an update on the delivery of the agreed measures in the budget plan for 2017-18. The report sets out a refreshed assessment of the delivery of agreed savings and efficiencies for the next year. Members are also presented with information on the revised timescales for release of the Scottish Government funding for local government and suggested revisions to the budget process, which takes account of those changes. Clearly, the timing of release of the funding figures in December will be an added challenge for this council in agreeing a budget in the new year. Adding to the uncertainty we already face in the scale of funding reductions. So there's challenges ahead. Paul is here to speak to the report and open up for members' debate. Andy?
Thanks, Leader. I'm just wondering if we could formalise something that, in your absence, Ted actually facilitated last year, was a meeting programmed in the whole process, where the cross parties sat and discussed potential items, where there would be consensus and agree those beforehand, and we kind of did that. And I found it helpful, and I'm just wondering if we should actually be putting that in sometime between January and 24th of February in the template on page 46. And so it's actually part of the process rather than just...
Yeah. No, well, that'll be a decision for the individual groups. That'll be a decision for our group, and I'm not... I'm not going to make a decision on the hoof. We won't. I don't know how your group works, but our groups, we have. We take it and we listen to people, and then we take a decision on it.
That's not what I said, Labour leader. I'm not talking about what our individual positions might be. I said I found the whole process very, very helpful. And whilst we might have.
As I said, Andy, that process was one that we implemented ourselves as an administration, as a group. We asked the other groups if they wanted to take part. Some of them did. Some of them were more helpful than others. But it's part of the process. It wasn't part of the process.
With respect, Leader, in actual fact, it was at the behest of full council. We asked for that process to happen. And to be fair, you did put it in place, but it was at full council, and I'm asking it for it to be included in the formal process, right? And I'd be quite happy to put that in as an extra recommendation if need be.
Okay. Jane?
Here's the question I forgot to ask or tried to ask earlier on. The 3.10, can I possibly just be reminded why we got 3.9% as opposed to 4.5%? The delivered local government funding, what was the difference between that figure? Can you just remind me what it was about?
3.9% was the average cut in local government funding across local authorities last year, but there's variations in terms of what individual authorities get through the distribution related to movements in population levels, movements in numbers of children at school, elderly people, things like that. We're one of the councils were actually at the floor, got the maximum reduction for councils last year, and that's why we were at the 4.5% level.
Was that new? Was that a newly introduced arrangement that's been
No,
historic?
That's a standard arrangement that's been in operation for a number of years.
Stephen?
Thanks, Leader. Just on 3.9, page 39, just the last sentence there, it obviously highlights the need for commitment from officers and members as being essential to secure delivery. I'm wondering again there, should we be explicitly including the input from staff representatives, unions, etc., because obviously the staff are the key part of how the council delivers services. So I'm just conscious it omits that, and could that be included rather than assumed?
Yeah, no problem with that. I think the point there is that we have a number of savings where the detail has still to be established. Those mainly relate to the service reviews, and obviously staff have a key input into each of those reviews, but happy to just formalise that in terms of the wording in the report.
The e-billing one is interlinked with the customer contact service review, the timescales for the implementation of that are having a knock-on impact on the deliverability of this saving, that the mechanisms and the frameworks that will be required for the implementation of the e-billing won't be in place in enough time to be able to secure the saving from the beginning of the new financial year. So it will still be achieved, but it'll be delayed until 2018-19.
Okay, and while I'm asking questions, why are the problems delivering ERVS in relation to building cleaning? Is it because there isn't enough interest? Is the information we have is that there is interest in ERVS?
The building cleaning one is in relation to difficulties in progressing some of them and being able to reduce, although they can apply reductions in their times, there are some individuals who are not wishing to take ERVS in the areas in which we would need to be able to deliver that saving in full. So you would have to reduce some individuals' contracts, which they're obviously not willing to do at the moment.
And the last one I've got is on page 50, it says we have a problem delivering on the savings in relation to the fleet and vehicle maintenance review. What exactly is that problem, and will the shortfall be made up in future years? Or are we saying that the £243,000 is the maximum savings that we can expect?
The majority of the shortfall in relation to the fleet and vehicle maintenance review is in relation to grey fleet mileage at the moment. They're progressing a number of opportunities and reviews in relation to how they can deliver that differently through looking at the pool cards and alternative mechanisms, primarily within social work and home carers. But at the moment, we haven't got that firm detail to be able to ensure that that will be delivered in full. But they're still working on making sure that further progress will be made in relation to that saving.
Thanks for that. Graham?
Hey, thanks, Chair. In page 47, there's Appendix 2, increased savings amount for 17-18 is projected to be £10.703 million. Now, how realistic is that? Because if it's only going to be £6 or £7 million, we have to find another £4 million somewhere to make up the difference for next year's budget. So how realistic is that 10.7?
That really is the thrust of the main part of this report. 10.7 was actually the figure you agreed in February, the target for next year. What this report's actually identifying is shortfalls against a handful of those savings, which mean that we're looking at about 193 million pounds available for next year's budget process. As we've identified in the report, that will not go half the way towards balancing the budget next year. Now, as we've identified that paragraph, it's 4.2. We're looking at a savings target over £20 million. So we're talking, further savings, significantly in excess of that figure to balance the budget for next year. But we think that 9.2 is the realistic level that will be delivered through those savings that have already been agreed.
Could I just come back, Chair? Is that 9.2 likely to move? Is it likely to get less?
No, again, we think this, obviously there's uncertainty, but we think this is a reasonably prudent estimate of the level of savings to be achieved through those that have already been agreed.
Okay. I think we still have a lot of difficulties with the budget coming up. We've had difficulties from the Scottish Government. We promised a three-year budget. We're now getting a one-year budget. And obviously the details of that budget will not be till the 15th of December. Maybe Andy can help out with that as well. The savings won't be significantly higher as a result of the late notification of local government finance settlement and the indications that I've said. We've got protected portfolios, and so it's going to be an extremely difficult time to estimate in advance of the Scottish Government announcement, and there's no formal opportunity for consideration of settlement until the new year. So with these difficulties, Andy, and if you can, maybe expedite a speedier response from the Scottish Government for us, I'm quite willing to put that forward as a motion if you want. No? Right, can we go to the recommendations? can be note 2.1, agree 2.2, note 2.3, and note 2.4. Andy?
Okay, leader. thanks for the opportunity to try and do your job for you. I'm wanting to insert in the programme on page 40, the template in page 46, that political groups somewhere between the 31st of January and 24th of February should have the opportunity to meet, discuss and potentially agree areas where there is consensus and have that as part of the process. So I'm happy to move that.
Yeah. It's not competent, Andy. The invitation should be at the discretion of the administration. You can't have a council decision it's at the discretion of the administration in preparation of its budget. It's entirely a matter for the administration and any other group who they want to work with. So under that, it's not competent.
Thanks for that. Then I can take it, leader, we're going to have a confrontational budget setting rather than a consensual one.
That's your opinion, and if that's the way you want to work, that's up to, entirely up to SNP.
Chair, sorry, but just a point of clarification. Under 2.2, agree a revised budget process, if somebody puts forward a motion to add something into the budget process, can I just have clarity that that isn't competent? I hear what you're saying, but I just want clarification from the governance officer. That isn't competent?
What Andy's proposing is incompetent. Tom?
Just a matter of clarification, I don't think that the council or a committee of the council has any right to instruct any individual councillor or group of councillors to do anything. You can only do things by consensus, by agreeing to it. Can't it be instructed? This committee hasn't got the right to instruct political groups what they can and cannot do. If you're going to make a suggestion that groups meet together, do that out with the meeting.
Leader, can I come back in?
No.
No, okay, I'm shut down. Thank you.
Okay. Can we go to the recommendations? We can note 2.1, agree 2.2, note 2.3, and note 4. Thank you.
Leader. Could I ask my dissent to be recorded?
Okay, thanks. Moving on to item 7, which is the support provide members with feedback of the recent public and staff consultation programme and the Council's budget for 2017-18. Members will recall that we agreed this consultation would take place as part of the budget process, and the work undertaken reflects the outline programme considered as committee on 16th of June 2016. The Council and local government across Scotland are facing significant financial pressures. It is important that we have an open dialogue with the public and our staff to inform our decisions in February. I welcome the high level of participation by members of the public and staff, recognising this has been achieved by reaching out to people in their local communities, making the engagement much more inclusive and accessible than ever before. I would particularly like to record my thanks to all 3,019 members of the public and staff who took the time to share their views and welcome the assurance that the detail behind all responses will be made publicly available and be provided to every elected member. Indeed, I think members will by now have received emails with the full list of comments received. There are one or two pages to get through. Kirsty's here to speak to the report. Members? Andy?
Thanks very much. It's interesting reading, including the big things which we only got yesterday. I appreciate Kirsty was available last week, so that's understandable. The one question I'm going to ask is, I don't think it's any my quick skim through the attachments we got, is when I went to the one in Northwest Resource Centre, there was a thing up in the board that actually said, areas where we charge, right? What do you think about this? Now, to the my memories, I'm not getting any younger, as you know. It's almost the responses that they're talking about here were what was on the board, and the board didn't actually go anywhere near showing the full extent of what this council charges for. And I understand why not, because it would have been prohibitive to have everything on one big notice board. But it would have been really helpful If we hindsight, it's a wonderful thing, if we'd had that available online for people to go and check and have a look at, some quite significant things were on that. And it's the only drawback I can find in the whole process, and it's no complaint, it's a suggestion for the future. And also, if Kirsty is able to provide us with what was actually on the notice boards, the information that was available for the public. Because if you only suggest half a dozen or eight areas, then you're leading people to those areas as opposed to other areas you might not. And I don't mean anything by that, but that's just a fact of life. So I'm just wondering if there's any comment on that.
Thanks, Councillor. I'm pleased if that's the only negative you've got for me, then I'm certainly happy to respond. I do have the information you request in terms of the charging fact sheet. We did struggle, I would say, to consider how much information and how much detail to give the public. We obviously range from having very detailed service review documents, for example, on fees and charges, to something that feedback from previous consultations members of the public were saying they wanted something a bit simpler and a bit more visual. I think you're probably right in terms of having that reduced information may well have only given members of the public a certain range of charges that we have in place, and some of the feedback definitely relates to those charges. So I can give you the fact sheet, and yes, I fully take your points on. We will be evaluating the full consultation process, and it's likely that some of the comment that you've explained there would be as a result of that, will no doubt come out.
Jim?
Thanks, Leader. There was certainly an issue in Wigtown area about the lack of notification with regard to the drop-in meetings. Now, it was reported in the press that one of the meetings attracted no members of the public whatsoever, and the reason being that the notice had only gone out a day or two before the meeting was due to take place. Community councils were trying to discuss the savings proposals after the drop-in meetings had occurred. Now, I really think that in future, far more notice requires to be given.
Thank you. We certainly have had feedback from some community councils regarding notice, and we'll fully take that on board as we do the evaluation. I'm pleased to give members from that area comfort in that the Stranraer drop-in session, and I think that was also a challenge for some of our community members who traditionally have participated in budget consultation meetings, was that this approach was much more about going to the public and having conversations and enabling them in the local facilities to be able to complete the questions, rather than what we have done previously was more a kind of formalised committee meeting where perhaps people felt obligated to have, you know, their say in a wider sense. But I am pleased to give you comfort that the first drop-in in Stranraer actually had our highest turnout. We had 56 members of the public complete the survey in Stranraer Library that morning. So whilst I totally take on board some of the feedback that we've had, and we actually ran another additional session to be able to respond to that, and we will obviously look at that as part of the evaluation, but pleased to see that was actually one of our highest, well, it was the highest turnout actually. So clearly people were active and keen to have the conversation there.
Looking through the support and the recommendations, I'm looking at recommendation 2, which says endorse the key messages as set out in paragraph 3.7, 3.9, appendix 2. I'm not sure if endorse is the right word for this recommendation. You know, I believe it ties members' hands, it ties groups' hands within that, and I would suggest we agree to note the feedback. I'm also not sure about the wording after appendix 2 in that same recommendation is needed, as it's an agreed process is that members will inform officers what options they wish to be developed through the individual groups and what they wish to do. Therefore, I would suggest that we note the key messages I set in paragraphs 3.7 and 3.9 and appendix 2 and finish there. Members? Okay. So we've considered one. We'll note, as I've said, note the key message I set in paragraphs 3.7, 3.9 and appendix 2 and 2. And note 3 and agree 4. Thank you. Oh, sorry, Andy.
Can we put somewhere in here on record the I think quite unprecedented number of staff who've actually been involved in this process online and everything else, and just record their support in this whole process.
Yeah. Do that. Stephen?
Sorry, it was just actually on 2.4, the engagement of stakeholders and impact assessments. So in paragraph 3.14, it does mention trade unions, community planning, equality, diversity group, and relevant stakeholder organisations are part of the process. Does that mean they will actually be represented when individual groups are having individual templates impact assessed? Just for a wee bit of clarification, it's where they fit into the actual process specifically.
Those organisations are part of the impact assessment process for the budget templates that are produced. I would need to check exactly where in the process that happens, Councillor Thompson, if I'm honest. I would need to come back to you on that.
Okay, moving on to item 8. We've actually finished that item.
Sorry, it's important. So I understand the disability groups, for example, are involved in setting or the whole thing, but it's the assessment of impact after the templates are completed that we're interested in, right? Not the form itself. And let's make it absolutely clear, we would expect the disability groups or whoever it would be, for example, a disability group who might be directly affected, right, should actually have some means of having an input into that impact assessment. That's the way the quality works.
They do, as far as I'm aware. They do have that.
They definitely are assessed by a representative group of those organisations, but I will come back to members with clarity on exactly when that happens. I suspect it's at the end once the templates are prepared, but I want to just come back to you to be clear.
Moving on to item 8, capital investment strategy. This report gives members information on progress so far in the Council's capital investment strategy for the current financial year. As at the end of September, the Council has spent over £13 million of the £47 million programme. This continues to be an important part of our contribution to support our local economy and delivering projects which are integral to our Council priorities. Paul is here to answer any questions arising from the report. Members? Okay. We've got the recommendations in. Can we note 1, 2, 3 and 4? Okay. Moving on to item 9. This report gives members an overview of the financial performance of corporate services for 2016-17. I'm pleased to note the projected position of the director and the continued support of staff with clear direction from senior officers to deliver a balanced budget. Lorna is here to deal with any questions arising from the report. Okay, can we go to the recommendations? Can we note 1, 2, 3 and 4? Item 10, this report seeks members' approval for the write-off debts which have a greater value than £10,000 and are deemed uncollectible. This is a six-monthly report we will receive as a committee for consideration and approval following improvements made to arrangements in response to internal audit recommendation. This responsibility is also now transferred from communities to the Corporate Services Directorate. The vast majority of sums owed to the Council are collected And I'm pleased to note the collection levels of council tax and non-domestic rates highlighted in paragraph 4.1, which provide a strong indication of this. Services carry out extensive work before recommending sums are considered for a write-off. Paragraph 4.4 of the report sets out the reasons where officers recommend write-off. Paul, I'll bring you in. You've got a comment on this first.
Yes, thanks, Leader. It's just a correction on page 101 of your papers in the table at paragraph 5.6. Just to point out that it doesn't affect overall thrust of the report, but the council tax line, the top line of that table, the value of write-offs is correct at £74,000, but the number of write-offs is not correct. It's the wrong figure that's in there. It should actually be 3,207. And what that reflects is we've actually had a major exercise to review and write off historic, relatively small amounts across a range of accounts. So we've actually done a tidy up exercise there. So the value is still correct, but it's a higher number in terms of value accounts that relates to.
With that, open up to members. Andy?
Just a quick question, thanks, Leader. On the table on page 105, about the rates, the write-off of rates, and also down the debtors further down in personal details have been removed. It's a joint question, really. Is have we finished, you know, prosecuted the process fully with administrators, liquidators, absentee landlords, or have we, and checking if people or advocates who act on behalf of people have actually been reducing their banking levels so that they're not liable, or their bank account statements, or they haven't got the money to pay it. And it's just really so that I'd like somebody to say to me, yes, we do go down that route, or we don't. And if we don't, then we'll need to reconsider that, because that's a process here. And a write-off of tax, for example, for big hedge funds.
Leader, what we do as much information and debt recovery as we can in each individual case. We do liaise with trustees in terms of companies that have been liquidated or going into administration. There's a slight difference in regards to those that are liquidated, in so much as there are no assets available, there are no funds available, so we're unlikely or definitely not get any funds back in those cases. Companies that are going into administration, then we do have a chance of getting monies back with regards from dividends from the trustees. We submit claims of the outstanding debt that we've written off at the point of time of the company going into administration to the trustees, and it's really dependent on the trustees identifying any dividends that they can give back to us, at which point in time we would reverse any write-offs that we've done and pay that money back into the account. In terms of the individuals, the individuals that are written off in terms of the debtors' cases, were all social services accommodation debtors, where we have billed for the residential accommodation. It's a case that their family representatives in these cases have not been able to release the funds to us. Debt is built up. The customer is now deceased in each case, and there are no funds having liaised with trustees and liaised with solicitors with regards to any estate that the client may have. There are no funds in the estate to pay the fund to pay the outstanding bills that we have.
Stephen.
Thanks, Leader. Same page 105. You're talking there about the chance of recovering monies through process, if you like. So obviously in that list there, there's a number of companies which are dissolved, or people who are deceased, etc. But there's one listed there in administration. Obviously that's sensitive at the moment, but are we prudent to write that off, given that there may be a chance of recovering some share of monies?
At this point in time, we do write off any company that goes into administration. The practice is to write off from the books so that we're not wasting our time, and the stats show that we're not trying to chase debt at that point in time is unrecoverable. We have, in that particular case, contacted and liaised with the trustees, submitted a claim in terms of what's outstanding for non-domestic rates. And the hope is that we may receive some dividend back from the trustees, but at this point in time, the full debt remains uncollectible, written off from the books. if and when we receive a dividend in the near future, that amount would be reversed. It may not be a full dividend, it may be 10 pence in the pound or what have you. We would reverse that amount and pay the funds in that we get from the trustees. So at this point in time, it's prudent for us to effectively wipe that debt off the books so that we're not effectively wasting our time trying to collect money that we know we can't get just now.
Does that get reported back through this, a future version of this report saying this is what's actually been recovered through 10 pence in the pound arrangements or whatever?
Well, so the total amounts that we do are effectively net write-off, write-on amounts. So any future reports that we bring to this committee, if we had made any write-ons to that effect, it would be reflected in future reports.
Graham?
Yeah, thanks, Chair. Halfway down page 105, there's HB debtor, one person details removed, £14,160. Official error details, local authority error. And if you read 4.4, I think it is, in the report, it explains that if there's been an overpayment which has been caused by not being informed of that's my reading, not being the authority, not being informed of the circumstances having changed, we can't claim it back. Has this always been the case, or is this a new thing? And are we clamping down? Are we making sure of being more careful in not overpaying people?
Chair, no, this has always been the case. In this particular case, the customer did supply us with the information. It wasn't acted on promptly, and that resulted in overpayment. Customer could not have known about these, so it is a local authority error, which we will recover back through subsidy.
Okay, can we go to the recommendation? Note and scrutinised. Thanks. Item 11, this report provides members with mid-year progress report on the Corporate Services Business Plan. It also provides detailed information on the Directorate's performance in relation to health and safety. In overall terms, the business plan contains a range of performance indicators and projects contributing to the delivery of our priorities and commitments, with the majority of these met and within acceptable limits. The details of areas where performance targets have not been met are contained within the exception reports in Appendix 2 and 3. Appendix 1 also provides a summary of the performance on health and safety, and I note that 100% activities are either complete or on target. Lorna's here, and members of the team are present to answer any questions. Members? Patsy?
Just on percentage of staff who have completed an annual performance development review on page 115, I mean, that's quite disappointing in some of them, and because it's in EEI and SIPL, whatever, I can't remember what that stands for. But I would have thought, you know, in those departments, they need to do the annual performance development review.
I think there's, I'll let Paul answer, but I think there's difficulty sometimes with the PDRs and that has actually been done, but it's probably maybe not been reported back in some instances.
Certainly, Ida, there are instances where they're not being recorded properly, and we're working with services to ensure that the recording mechanisms are there and we're getting full credit for anything. One of the main reasons at the moment is the period of transition with line manager changes, which are causing delay in the identified person who would do the PDR. So that's actually a big factor at the moment. And we've given a deadline for all outstanding PDRs to be completed by 31st of March, and to even take that into account. And where it's unclear, we'll get someone nominated to make sure that happens.
Andy?
Thanks. It's the same box, the same on page 115. I'm particularly worried about the SIPL one, given that they're looking after probably the most vulnerable people in the region are getting looked after within that department. And we're down to a two-thirds of the staff, so that's a third of the staff aren't actually getting through the process here for whatever reason. But the hands-on delivery of education and social work hasn't changed that much. It's just maybe... So the ongoing professional supervision should also be in there as well. Is that included in this figure, the professional supervision, or is that over and above this?
The PDR process is standalone, and obviously supervision plays into that. But one of the issues there is actually the recording of teachers' PDRs. We're experiencing some difficulty in the accurate recording of that, and I'm currently having a discussion with the director as to how we actually improve that to bring that statistic more in line with what we believe is actual.
Thanks for letting me back in, Leader. It would be really helpful then, Paul, if in a big department like SIPL, if we could actually have a breakdown of the service areas where we've got a problem, and if there is that problem within teaching, for example, yes, then we need to know about it. But equally, if it's in the social work side, or if it's in the leisure and sports side, or whatever part of that big department, I'm seeing Jeff sitting nodding. So I think to get that information for members would be helpful. And let us understand the position more clearly.
Happy to make sure that's provided.
Okay, can we go to the recommendations? 2.1, 2.2 and 2.3, we've reviewed, read, scrutinised. Okay. 12, workforce strategy update. This is 2015-2020 update, report by Head of Organisational Development, Human Resources and Assets. Members will recall we agreed our Council 5-year workforce strategy last year, and also agreed that we receive annual updates on the progress of the plan which was set out to deliver the strategy. The report provides us with an update on progress and achievement so far, and indicates the work being developed in directorates to support effective workforce planning. I recognise through the significant change and reductions in our workforce, it is important that we focus as far as possible on the longer term through development and support for our employees, and I welcome the ongoing work to make sure we achieve this. Paul and James is here to answer any questions. Members? Andy?
Thanks, Leader. Actually, I welcome this piece of work. It's obviously been much needed. It may have been helpful for me, what they used to say, if you give a man a picture, he understands it better. If we'd had a city traffic light system exactly where we were, we just see at a glance, the bits there, that's just I hope a helpful thing, Jamie. But the bit, at least a wee bit explanation in the bits, the bullet point near the bottom of page 129, promoted our council as a first career option and employer of choice. A wee bit of information about how we actually did that would be really helpful.
Yeah, thanks, Andy. I think it's something that the council itself is moving forward with at pace. I think being an employer of choice, and I think there's some good examples out there of that. And I think the graduates and MA are two good examples of that. As you can see in some of the information that's further on, the graduate scheme is 100% that are looking for future employment, and the same with MAs. There's 93% are looking for future employment either within the council or out with the council. So I think both these examples are areas where we're proving that we are an employer of choice.
Okay, can we go to recommendations? We have reviewed 2001 and note 2. Item 13, this report presents us with a draft procurement strategy for our consideration. Officers are asking for our comments and input ahead of further consultation with internal and external stakeholders, and thereafter a presentation to full council. The report highlights that this will replace our current strategy and reflects the requirements of recent legislation and regulations. I welcome the clarity and it provides in incorporating the Council's approach to paying the living wage into this, and also ensuring we receive formal reporting on the delivery of the strategy. The report also asks for approval of a sustainable procurement policy required by legislation, recognising this will be supported with training and guidance for services. Paul and Karen are here to answer any questions. Jill?
Thank you, Leader. I shall be aware. I am very interested in procurement, and I actually am pleased to see this strategy with us today. The only thing I would say is that maybe there's two or three things that might need tidied up a little bit, and maybe members would like to add a little bit more into the document. And for that reason, I would be suggesting that we would be allowed to do that between now and it actually going to full council. And I would like to just put that forward. I don't think there should be an issue with that, but I think it would be helpful.
Do you want officers to go around the groups?
I think that might be helpful. I think it would be a useful piece of work if everybody was happy with that.
Okay, that's fine. No problems. Anything else? No. Okay, considered, can be approved too. Thank you. At 14, this report provides a draft digital and ICT strategy for our consideration and approval. The covering report outlines the approach taken to the development strategy and the focus on the Council's priorities, with a view to ensuring we maximise the impact of our resources and investments on these areas. I welcome the fact that the strategy makes clear that the changes we wish to happen in service delivery are at the forefront of the considerations in the strategy. Members will recall that in receiving the outcomes of various service reviews, there is clearly a focus on improved use of ICT and digital alternatives in many of these cases. It is therefore vital that we get the strategy right. Graham's here to answer any questions. Members? Stephen?
Thanks, Leader. Welcome this report, I suppose. It's good to have a strategy so we know where we're going. There's a couple of questions just about the actual meat of it. Could you maybe tell me a bit more about the enterprise mobility suite in terms of what impact that'll have on how we do what we're doing already and how that'll improve it, and what systems it might mean we don't need to keep continuing, which may not be fit for purpose, would be one question. I'll come back with another question after, if that's okay, Leader.
Yes, Enterprise Mobility Suite is an alternative to what you would recognise as the Good for Enterprise Suite that you get your email on your mobile devices. The advantage of the Enterprise Mobility Suite is, one, licensing costs are cheaper, so there's a potential saving there. But what it does, it gives us a lot more functionality, particularly around the security of devices and the security of our applications. It means that rather than the application of all the security measures that we have, we should be able to reduce those and make the security, put the security onto the application rather than onto the device, which potentially gives us the opportunity then to explore the use of other devices other than the ones that we provide at the moment, so potentially your own device as well. The implementation of it, what we're trying to do at the moment is have it presented to members or anyone using a mobile device as an application on that device. So you'd click on the application and it would open up a range of other pieces of software that you have access to. It would mean that you would get the same opportunities to use software either on a mobile device, on a laptop, on a tablet or whatever. It would be exactly the same no matter what device you're using. So that's where we're trying to go with the Enterprise Mobility Suite. I say the replacement, it's about replacing the Good for Enterprise product we have at the moment, which is going end of life in March, and also potentially replacing some of the licensing overheads associated with Microsoft Office as well.
Thanks very much. So in summary, it'll be an application, which means it frees up any restrictions on the types of devices we might use. So that will, as you said, it's tied to the application, not the device.
It'll certainly relinquish some of the security issues we'll have. I wouldn't go as far as to say it would be available on any device.
Thanks.
I think there's a huge queue for folk wanting to ask questions anyway, but I think, I mean, tied into this obviously must be how we're addressing corporately the likes of the what was called previously the Amazon experience, if you like. So whether or not a member of the public or an elected member or even an officer, I suppose, raises a query, there should be a unified approach to how that gets managed and how the response gets back to the person who made the inquiry. At the moment, we seem to have a sort of cobbled together number of different systems that do that, and not everybody adheres to them maybe as well as the next person. So I'm just wondering, in layman's terms, how is that going to be delivered by this strategy, and how long will it take? I'm conscious very much at the moment that some departments seem to be using mobile working, but yet that seems to be a bit anomalous across the council as a whole, and it's hard for us to see the benefits of that in terms of reporting back to constituents or the like.
The strategy highlights in a fair bit of detail about the use of digital services and that type of an approach. One of the basic premises of digital services about looking at the business processes that are in behind and making those as automated as possible. So the customer experience, you know, it should come in from the customer report into our CRM system. That system will then automatically generate the responses that are required and feed it into the directorate-based systems for attention and completion. And again, that message should come back. But it's all about taking time to integrate the systems that we use properly and test them properly. But in reference to your comment about different systems doing different things, yes, we are in that position at the moment. And one of the threads in the strategy is about looking at those systems and rationalising them where possible.
Thanks, Leader. So I presume, I know we've discussed this in previous times, but just about the use of the lagging system, and maybe that there's scope for maybe expanding how well that can cover some of the things we need it to do, given that I think we're on an older system of that at the moment. But obviously there'd have to be the requisite training, because I presume that whether you phone, pop into an office, email something or whatever it might be, as soon as that gets into our contact centre, that should all effectively through our trained staff go into the system to be allocated or dealt with appropriately. And is that something that Lagan or some future incarnation of Lagan can do?
The answer is simply yes. I think what we're trying to go to in the strategy is to provide a similar experience to customers or to yourselves, no matter where you report that piece of information or that request. So Lagan will be the key corporate system to deal with all that information. Yes, it does need an upgrade, and we're working at the minute with communities to schedule that in.
The other thing, I think I've asked this before, but it's really about public access to Wi-Fi in generic council buildings like customer centres, libraries, etc., or integrated facilities, if you like. I mean, 21st century, you know, the usual kind of things like that, but really there should be, I think, enhanced scope for members of our public to access digital services, because we know already that there's an issue about the rollout of the likes of broadband, about mobile connectivity, but surely we should be able to, with our infrastructure and our network, be able to use some of that capacity to deliver some kind of monitored or appropriate public Wi-Fi in council buildings. I mean, is that where is that, and how long are we from actually delivering that across the region?
We're not that far away. However, the capacity of our current infrastructure to deliver that additional functionality is not as prevalent as you might think. We maintain our networks at an optimum level for council business. We don't have
significant amounts of additional bandwidth available. From a the previous committee, I said I would prepare a report for members. That's going to the members' focus group this afternoon to indicate the level of expenditure that will be required to put public Wi-Fi in council buildings.
Okay. No, I'm bringing Jim in first. Jim?
Yeah, thanks. It's really, I'll be a bit less technical than Stephen here. We have Wi-Fi in the building and in several other council buildings. We come in here and our council supplied mobiles can't get on to the Wi-Fi. Yet I can walk into my house and my council supplied mobile phone will pick up my Wi-Fi and will deliver my emails, etc., etc., to my phone via Wi-Fi. That seems utterly strange to me. Why can the council mobile phone no pick up the council Wi-Fi?
It is an anomaly in our infrastructure at the moment. It's predicated on our PSN requirements, which are public service network requirements, to allow connectivity to partners like Department of Work and Pensions, Criminal Justice and so on. The Cabinet Office have decreed that mobile phones are not secure devices to be connected to the corporate network. We are in process of working through that with them, however, the current caveats around the use of or connecting mobile devices to the corporate network is as it is, unfortunately.
Are the NHS on a different system then? Because I can go up to the NHS and get connected in my mobile to the NHS.
The answer is yes, they are. The NHS are not PSN compliant, which is one of the current issues that we have around health and social care integration as well. There are a difference in levels of security.
Gail?
Thank you, Leader. I sometimes think that I work for MI6 with the security levels that we have on our devices. You can go to the Scottish Parliament, where you have MSPs and people probably far more data protected than we are, and connect with any device in the Scottish Parliament. So I simply don't understand this logic. I understand that we have the highest level of security of any council in Scotland, and it's prohibitive. It's not helpful at all. It's too much. And I'd like to know why we have to have that level when nobody else seems to have it.
I'll refer back to PSN compliance. The answer to that should be no. However, all local authorities should be PSN compliant and to the same standard, as should the Scottish Government. It is something that we're looking into. You'll see one of the strands in the strategy is about safe and secure ICT, and that means that we're going to take a look and review all the security measures that we have in place. However, PSN and the Cabinet Office are very clear in what our restrictions and the restrictions on our devices have to be.
Hey, Stephen.
No, it was just, is there a spoiler alert? I mean, I think I'm on this ICT focus group this afternoon, but I'm not the only one. Have you got a heads up as to what the indicative price would be to have public access Wi-Fi?
Sorry, I thought I had it with me. I don't. I'll have it for this afternoon.
Well, Mark, can we go to the recommendations? Can we approve 1, agree 2, 4 and 5 and note 3? Thank you. Item 15, this report provides us with the initial proposals published by the Boundary Commission for Scotland and changes to the UK parliamentary constituencies. I'm sure members, political groups or groupings and the wider public will seek to make their voice heard on these matters during the very limited consultation process that is being held. However, traditionally the Council has also made a submission, and given that there are some very obvious anomalies and frankly ridiculous suggestions in relation to Dumfries and Galloway, I suspect that may well be the case again today. The Boundary Commission always seems to try to surpass themselves when it comes to ignoring local ties and communities, and when they do these number crunching exercises, and I know they don't disappoint us today. From the administration's point of view, there are parts of the proposals that we believe to be particularly ill thought out that should be changed, and which I believe cut across all parties. I will go through these if I'm allowed. The first is the fact that Locker Biggs and Heath Hall from Locker Ward has been placed in the proposed Clydesdale and Esdale constituency rather than in Dumfries and Galloway constituency with the rest of the town of Dumfries. The second part of the proposal we believe is wrong is the fact that Annandale South Ward, which includes the towns of Annan and Gretna, has been placed in Dumfries and Galloway constituency, which splits it up from the rest of Annandale and Esdale. If you swapped Locker Biggs and Heath Hall in Ward 9 with Annandale South Ward, I think technically you would end up with a Clydesdale and Esdale constituency slightly above the target figure of voters by a few hundred. However, this could be easily dealt with by changes further north in Lanarkshire. I'm sure there will also be further changes in Lanarkshire as well, so I'm not going to make any suggestions for that. Other than to suggest, we put forward the principle of swapping Locker Biggs and Heath Hall with Annandale South in any submission we make. In addition, we think the third mistake the Commission has made is to restrict the options for Dumfries and Galloway region by combining us with Lanarkshire only. This ignores, for example, the strong links between Ayrshire and parts of the region, for example, South Ayrshire and Stranraer and East Ayrshire and Upper Nissedale. We would therefore suggest that they widen the grouping to include considerations also to be given to parts of Galloway being linked to parts of Ayrshire in any proposals. We would suggest that these 3 points are made in a council submission, including asking an officer to attend the inquiry on the 24th of November, simply to make these points. Members? Gail?
Leader, I'd certainly be very happy to support your first suggestions about Locker Briggs and Heath Hall and Annan and East Riggs. It's been a desktop exercise that I think has been based on the A75 and the bypass, pure and simply, and it's absolutely absurd. That doesn't affect the number significantly and shouldn't pose a problem to the Boundary Commission. Your further proposals will. So I'm afraid I can't support the second part of your proposals, but I'm very happy to support the Anne and Heath Hall, Locker Briggs, East Riggs proposal.
The only reason I was saying about between Ayrshire and South Ayrshire, example, is it's, we agreed it before. You know, it makes sense. You know, it's taken a bit. It actually makes sense, and we've agreed it as a council before. So that's the reason. I mean, all parties. But, yeah, Gail, yeah, John.
I'm happy to support Gail and her suggestion. I'm not keen to support your third part because I do think it would have a knock-on effect in numbers, etc. So I'm happy to agree to the first two.
Leader, this has just come to us just now, and I'm wondering if... given us a significant bit, and it's what, 12 o'clock now, if we're going to have a break during this committee, we actually might bring this back and give us a chance to look at your suggestions. On the surface, one seems sensible. Yeah? The first bit, the second bit, I'm not too sure exactly what it all means. And the other thing I think we should be putting into would be that we're opposed to the reduction of elected parliamentarians, and have to be opposed to the increase in the unelected house, which seems to be gathering a fair rate of knots. So that that general comment needs to be in there as well.
Okay, Jeff.
Councillor Thompson, I obviously represent the one ward which has been split out of the rest of Dumfries. We made this argument, I think it was in 2003, that Heath Hall and Lockerbriggs were part of the town of Dumfries. The Boundary Commission accepted it then, so what's changed to make it a foreign part of Dumfries? You know, this is just a numbers crunching game. If you're within 200 or 300, what difference does that make out of a population of 75,000 if it actually maintains the local ties? And that's one of the basis on which the Boundary Commission is supposed to make its decision. It recognises and maintains local ties, unless, of course, it doesn't suit its numbers, in which case these ties are severed. And they go against a recommendation which they accepted before. So it is nonsense. You know, it is totally anti-democratic, the process which they're suggesting we're going through. So certainly I would support what's been proposed in terms of swapping the Annan with the Locker Ward.
Jim, sorry, I forgot about you there.
Yeah, thanks, Leader. And I don't think there's been anybody that's been willing to actually second the leaders. So I'm perfectly willing to second the leaders. Having looked at the previous one way back, the proposals, and I should maybe declare an interest here coming from South Ayrshire, but I'm sorry, the folk in the west of the region have far more in common with the folk in South Ayrshire than what they have with the folk in the very east of this region. So it is a perfectly legitimate reason to look at, considering the Boundary Commission had actually looked at it before and put the west of the region in with South Ayrshire. So I'm quite happy to second the leader's proposal on the 3 points.
Okay.
It's all very well for people who've got previous knowledge, but a lot of us don't have any knowledge of what happened before. And I would like to see it in writing before we actually say it.
I mean, it's not something that, you know, it's something that we have strong links, as Jim has said, with South Ayrshire and, you know, with the Ayrshire, so, East Ayrshire.
We're as Langham, we hoik.
But, you know, if you look at Finnish, Andy, and that's the only reason we were putting that in there, because it had been muted before and it had all party agreement on that. So, I mean, it's not something that, you know, it's something to be explored. I doubt very much we won't get very far with it, but, Tom.
Yeah, could I just back up what Jim was saying there? Members will recall back in 2012, I think it was, the previous Conservative Lib Dem government held a referendum across Britain on whether to have PR or not. Now, that was at the whim of the Lib Dems. What the Conservatives wanted then was to cut the number of constituencies from 650 to 600. They came up with a set of maps then. I'll wait till the conversation's finished there. They came up with a set of maps then, which were considered by this committee, which, and Councillor McClung is quite correct, which did show the former constituency of Dumfriesshire, which existed up until 1979, would be restored, along with Galloway going in with parts of West Ayrshire. Now, this went through this committee without any dissent, as I recall. However, since the referendum that the Lib Dems wanted was lost, the Tory government could not implement their boundary changes then. What I find really strange is that the Boundary Commission, in the space of 4 years, can actually change their modus operandi, because what they proposed before satisfied the same criteria as today. So I think what has been proposed by the Leader and Councillor McClung is perfectly reasonable. It's no different to what this Council agreed to 4 years ago.
Rolf.
Thanks, Leader. Yeah, I think the more that I see suggestions from either Boundary Commission, national or local government, the less time I have for either body, I think, to be brutally frank. I could do just to hear again, I think it was option, or not options, but parts 2 and 3. One I absolutely agree with, I think it's sensible. I recognise very clearly the previous map that had, I think the constituency was to be called Galloway and Carrick or something of that nature. I have to say that there is a fundamental problem with this. I don't actually accept the premise of the question. I don't think that the overall reduction in MPs, and it may be strange for a nationalist making this point, but nevertheless, the overall reduction in MPs is particularly clever at this point. I think that the premise of the question is flawed. Nevertheless, since it has been posed, we have to ask it, or we have to answer it, rather. So if you wouldn't mind just... I think points one and three I'm clear on. I can't remember what you said as point two.
Okay, I'll go through it again, but said, if you swapped Lockie Biggs and Heath Hall in Ward 9 with Annandale southward, you would end up with a Clydesdale and Esdale constituency, but that would be slightly above the target figure, so by a few hundred, which could be dealt with by further changes in North Lanarkshire, but I can't make the points for North Lanarkshire. Put forward the principle, so that part there, we put forward the principle of swapping Lockie Biggs and Heath Hall and Annandale South in any submission we make. I think we've all agreed on that. Okay. In addition, we think that the third mistake the Commission has made is to restrict the options for Dumfries and Galloway region by combining us with Lanarkshire only. It ignores the strong links, as I've said, between the Ayrshires as part of the region. Stranraer in East Ayrshire and Stranraer in South Ayrshire and East Ayrshire and Upper Nithsdale, and we would therefore suggest that they widen the grouping to include consideration also be given to parts of Galloway being linked with to other parts of Ayrshire in the proposals. And all I'm doing is suggesting that the officer makes these points. Right, everybody's put their hand up here. I think Graham's first.
Thank you, Chair. I totally agree with Annan and Lockie Briggs and Heath Hall, no problem with that. What you haven't identified is how much of South Ayrshire do you want to take in? The Ayr and Carrick County constituency has got 77,000 voters, 77,352. Dumfries and Galloway County constituency is 78,093. Now, these both fall within the category of numbers that the number crunchers have decided is appropriate. What I'm wondering is, if you take in a lump of South Ayrshire into Dumfries and Galloway, you're going to exceed the appropriate numbers. And you haven't told us where you draw the line across in South Ayrshire.
These, we're asking for consideration to be given to them, looking at that, you know, and coming back with that. So it's not something that's in stone. You know, I haven't got figures and say we want 2,000 out of South Ayrshire or 5,000 out of the other bit or whatever. But it's something to consider where the links tie in. So it's not something that's...
Chair, just... I think the Boundaries Commission have looked at that because I was party to another presentation in a different venue, and they had certainly looked at bringing a bit of South Ayrshire in, and they've obviously in their final recommendations have discarded that for whatever reason. I don't know.
And they made such a good job with that, didn't they? The other considerations with Lockie Biggs and Heath Hall. So, but yeah. Andy?
Thanks, Leader. Thanks for that clarification. I'm now fully up to speed with exactly what you were meaning there. So, effectively, what we're given is the people who're going to represent us at 2.3, the mandate from this committee or this council to take forward that option and ask them to consider that. So, on that ground, I think you're right, and we would agree with that, I would suggest. And Jim's already, he understood the situation better than I did.
Okay, I think we've got a motion. Gail?
Yeah, it's really just a point on my motion. I think as a council, it's incumbent on us to protect the people of Lockie Briggs, Heath Hall, Annan and East Riggs and keep their local links. That should be our absolute priority. It doesn't change the numerical structure of the
seats
significantly. It's a swap, and that should be our absolute priority. The third part muddies the water because you're then affecting other areas' boundaries, and I don't think the Boundary Commission will accept that. And I think it could actually jeopardise us protecting our local communities.
Yeah. I think the other areas won't be putting points in as well, but you've got a motion there and you've got a second up by John. And can I move that in the comments? Can we agree that a verbal submission is made at the public hearing on the 24th of November, which opposed the current proposals in relation to Lochabiggs and Heath Hall and Annandale South, and against only linking the region with Lanarkshire and not considering the Ayrshires. So these are the points that officers should make. I agree that the representation to commission public hearing as detailed in the report.
And I'm quite happy to second that one.
Okay. Everybody can make their own representations anyway. You know, you can go and you can do what you want. So, okay, can we go to the vote?
So the motion is Councillor McGregor's, and that's for the leader's suggestions minus that relates to Galloway and the Ayrshires and Upper Nithsdale. And the leader's is the amendment, which is as described. So we'll go to the vote. Leader.
Amendment.
Deputy Leader.
Amendment.
Councillor Dykes.
Motion.
Councillor Ferguson.
Amendment.
Councillor Gilroy. Councillor Lever.
Amendment.
Councillor McGregor. Councillor Maitland.
Abstain.
Apology of Miss Councillor Davidson.
Amendment.
Thank you. Councillor Marshall, not here. Councillor McCautry.
Amendment.
Councillor McClung.
Amendment.
Councillor McComb.
Amendment.
Councillor Nicol.
Motion.
Councillor Ogilvie.
Amendment.
Councillor Scobie.
Amendment.
Councillor Thompson.
Amendment.
Councillor Tuckfield.
Motion.
The amendment is carried.
Okay, can we move on to item 16? What time is it? I don't know if anybody. Do you just want to carry on, members, or do you? Okay. Right, item 16, which is the Civic Government Scotland Act, Dumfries Taxi Zone. This report relates to requests from licensing panels to consider the policy in relation to transfer of taxi operators' licences and ask members to consider a withdrawal of existing policy, and also that a survey is conducted into demand for taxis in the Dumfries Taxi Zone. Willie is here to answer any queries. Andy?
Thanks very much. Through you, I'd just like to ask Willie, the recommendation of 2.1 has got a bit subject to a significant lead-in period. I would bow to his greater knowledge of the system here. Is there a legal reason or is there guidance that actually requires that, or can we just say set a date, for example? Is there a process we have to go through? That's my question.
It was really a part of the recommendation by members, and I think it is a prudent one, that rather than come to an automatic conclusion, you allow a period of time in which the trade can work out their own businesses. So it would also mitigate against any adverse impact on the holders of the 70 plates.
Andy, I'll lay back in now.
So, if there was a will of the committee to actually say, well, have this done within a period of time, that's actually legitimate. We can actually do that. Like, that's my point. Right, because these things have got a habit of rumbling on and on and on. And I think, having been party to some of the stuff with you, Willie, you know, it's there's a discomfort amongst the operators, there's a discomfort among everyone, the members of the panel, everything else. And I'm just wondering if we should actually be taking the lead here and saying, yeah, but we're going to have it done within a period of time, not a significant lead-in period. Let's give some leadership here and let's set something up.
Jim?
Yeah, thanks, Leader. It was really just along the same point. If there's no legal reason why we can't put a time limit on it, I'm no willing to sign up to a significant lead-in period. Significant to one person could be 3 months, to another person it could be 3 years. We need to have absolute clarity for everybody that within so many months it's changing, and that's it.
Sorry, Leader, there's a misunderstanding. I don't think the licensing panel was saying that it should be so nebulous that it's just going to be a significant period. The matter is put to members here to decide what that significant period should be.
Tom, do you want anything? No.
No, I think there's reasons why the panel went down that road. I mean, it's something that's been debated at numerous meetings, and we're aware that because of the sort of custom and practice for 30-odd years, to cease immediately may cause problems. And I think that maybe the word significant was the wrong word, but I think probably resolved within 12 months. But the thing is, if you put a time on it, you're putting constraints on, I would think.
Okay. I'll let Patsy in.
Yes, it's just about this. I mean, that's the main thing I picked up about this word significant lead-in. And I just wonder why we just don't make the decision, and that's what happens now. I don't understand why we've got to have a lead-in. Don't see what it does. I think we've got a policy that's not being adhered to. We've got a problem. We need to sort it. And leadership has been called for, and I would suggest that we just implement our present policy.
I think the policy is being adhered to, but they're looking at anomalies within that. And I think the reason for the timescale is that it gives people the opportunity to comply with the new rules that's coming in, and gives them an opportunity for the taxi licences they hold to actually pass them on. Which, instead of just saying it starts from now and everything's changed, it's actually a business these people have run in before and they paid money into that. So they are complying with what's happening now, and but, we'll want to change it in this paper.
Just for clarification, I think what's come about is that licences are being sold, and they're not meant to be. They're meant to come back to the council so that the council can reissue them to people who are on the waiting list. And that is the fundamental part of a licence, I'm led to believe. And therefore, it's not being complied with. So I think that's what we should be making sure happens within the licensing thing, and that there are people waiting on the waiting list who get gazumped, for want of a better word, and that is not right, and we are endorsing it.
Tom?
Yeah, but I mean, that was one of the issues that came up with the waiting list there. When we were asking when it was last updated, it hadn't been updated for about 10 years. There's 53 people on the list, including current operators, and one guy freely admitted, I just put my name back on the list every time I get another licence. Now, we have got a sort of definitive list there, and it's, I think it's not quite finish it. Well, we can keep me right on that, but it's a significant number less than was on the original list. But there was a policy there, or custom and practice there, going way back to the mid-80s, that operators, I mean, it was one business, I think he acquired other businesses, and he paid a substantial amount of money, and that is the way things had operated over a number of years. And rather than just cease it overnight, I think, because this has been debated at the licensing panel on 3 or 4 occasions over the last couple of years, and if we're going to change the policy, then there's got to be a lead-in period to change that policy. I mean, because we're in the public forum, I can tell there's loopholes to get around it anyway that isn't going to stop what you're trying to stop. But I think that this is a way of changing the policy, and I think at the end of the day, if folk aren't happy with what's coming, maybe should put it back down to the licensing panel, because this is a fairly complex subject. I know key members of the licensing panel have got a fair bit of knowledge about it, but those folk who aren't in the licensing panel, I think to try and change things today would be the wrong move. I think if there's any doubt there, send it back down to the licensing panel with your concerns.
I think that's a good point, because I think if you don't give an opportunity or a scene to be in a fairness in what we're doing as a council, it's my opinion that it'd be open to challenge in a legal basis, I would say. But John?
Thank you. I don't sit in the licensing panel. However, it's come to this committee for us to make a decision, and I do think that we need to give some sort of lead-in time. I think that's right. I don't think it should be immediate. I think we should put a lead-in time in, but I would suggest maybe a six-month period would be sufficient. I don't know how other members think.
Okay, Andy.
Thanks. I'm happy to give it to Ted, because I think he was wanting in, and I'll come in after that.
So I do sit on the licensing panel. I believe that a significant period, you know, should be in excess of 6 months. You know, I think it's important to existing operators that they're given a chance to actually, you know, do something or at least consider where they are on running their businesses currently. I think a reasonable period would be probably towards the end of 2017. I'm happy listening to the views of other members.
Andy?
Thanks. Like the Provost, I'm on the licensing panel as well, and a lot of this is brought about, quite frankly, because one of the reasons this is here is I personally think that we place officers in an invidious position here. They're working on custom and practice. The very localised one here is different from the rest of the region. And we need to formalise that. I don't think there's any doubt across the chamber we need to change this some way, right? So we're needing some reasonable solution. You're absolutely right, Leader. But I would still like to have some form of time, whether that's 6 months or 1 year from today or whatever it would be, so that there is a target and the work towards that. Because if we let it just slide on and slide on and slide on, the other reason we're here, of course, was because that was exactly the position that was happening in the licensing panels. We couldn't make a decision because we weren't sure, because we were operating within existing practice, and the only place to change that is here. So we need to do something positive, and I'd suggest that we actually go with the recommendations but withdraw it. But ideally, I would have liked 6 months, but I think common sense tells me a year, right? And so to have it sorted within the year, and that gives everybody ample time to do it and to get things sorted in that period of time. So I'd happy to say yes, but let's have it, if it's a year from today or a year, at your will, Leader, you know, work a year from when, and but didn't say me.
Okay, that's fine. Thanks, Andy. Jim?
Thanks, Leader. A number of operators have invested significant amounts of money in acquiring licences, and not to allow a significant lead-in time for restructuring would basically make their investment worthless overnight. I would agree with Ted. I think towards the 12-month period would be more appropriate than a short lead-in of only 3 months.
Graham?
Yeah, I mean, this has been bandied about for the past 6 months. So we've already lost 6 months, maybe longer. There were rules in place. These rules have been forgotten about or bypassed. And we've created a trade in something which should never have been allowed to happen. They're selling something which doesn't belong to them, and that is, I think it's illegal to sell something that you don't own. And we need to get back to the system whereby we have a list, and any person who gives up their business for whatever reason
The licence is returned to the council for reallocation from a person who's top of the list. But people have been on that list for 6, 8, 10 years. We've got, people have been on it for a month, 2 weeks even. And so they're bypassing this system, and that is not correct. So I appreciate that we need a lead-in time, but I would propose that we have that lead-in time. We set that lead-in time at 6 months and no more, because we need to bring this. The people who are involved in this know about this system, and I'm quite sure that within 6 months, I better watch what I'm saying here. Within 6 months, they will have sorted out their position. So I would propose that we make the lead-in period 6 months and no longer. And that would be from whenever we can implement that. I don't know if there's a lead-in time from this meeting today, but perhaps Rona could tell us how long that could be.
Yeah, well, so it's 6 months, well, the lead-in time of 6 months, is it, Graham? Right. Stephen?
Thanks, Leader. I think somebody's been at number one on the waiting list since 6th of January 2003. So clearly there's an inequity there, or why do we have a list in the first place? Big question. Anyway, we're here to make that decision. Just on page 323, just a wee bit of clarification. I'm not on the licensing panel, but I was curious as to the summary of actions arising from the impact assessment. And I'm helpfully advised that it's transfer details from table at number 26. I'm just wondering what that is. Page 323. It's on an impact assessment.
If it was quite difficult getting it within an impact assessment, because normally it's to do with introduction of a policy rather than the withdrawal of a policy. The fact is that if you withdraw the policy, there'll be no actions following that.
I think that's maybe a typo of that. I think it's maybe... Yeah, I think it's just a typo that's in there.
Oh, sorry, that is a standard part of the form. Oh. That is not something that we've input. That's an instruction.
Got Jim McClung, Jeff Lever, and then Andy. And we'll finish up there.
Yeah, thanks, Leader. I would agree with Councillor Tedto and my leader. 12 months, I'll even go as far as to say to cover the 48-hour recall that we actually put a date on it and say 30th of November 2017, and that's it finished.
Okay, Jeff.
Yeah, I'm conscious of the time, the fact that we seem to be going round and round in circles on this, so I'm quite happy with that proposal. And if there's a motion or an amendment against that, then I suggest we go to the vote now.
Yeah, I said a lot, Andy, and so.
Thanks very much. Just the last bit of rationale. The people who have been sitting on the licensing panels, when these transfers are coming across, I would suggest this might bring about a rash of people wanting to transfer under the existing policy. And if we do it at 6 months, we're going to lose at least 3, 4, 5 weeks over the sort of mid-December to mid-January period. So it's no really giving people that much time. I'm thinking more of the staff here, and I'm not thinking about the taxi drivers, particularly at this, or the operators at this moment in time. That's why I eventually went for a year, because Willie and his team need time, and the panels need time to consider them fully, because they'll all on their individual merits. So it's the time factor for me. That's why I'm saying a year. And like Jeff, I just moved to vote, I think.
Okay, we're going to the vote.
Chair.
Sorry?
I'm quite happy to withdraw my 6 month suggestion. It was right. Just a suggestion. I said that at the time. I don't think we should have to go to a vote on.
So you're quite happy with the 30th of November?
On our timescale, you know. But I would, can I ask a question? Obviously, I don't sit on your taxi panel, but I just want to ask a question. And it's just on your 2.1, where it talks about
you know, obviously we've got a problem of taxi licences not coming back for the people that are on the waiting list, and that waiting list, as Councillor McCaughtry said, people have been there for 10 years on that waiting list. But I really don't see that it's going to make any difference if we're agreeing to the part that actually tells us that the purchaser will be permitted to apply for the taxi operator's licence in advance of all other persons on the waiting list. So, you know, I don't really see what difference it's going to make about the taxi licences coming back. But I appreciate that you want to change the policy, so 12 months is okay by me.
I think it should be withdrawn. The fact is that that whole policy would be withdrawn from the end of November 2017. But can I just say that there's no insinuation that operators have been working clandestinely here. But this is an open policy which has been going on since 1985, 86. There's been a waiting list at the same time. Those two might be inconsistent. They've been inconsistent since the beginning, not since the last few panel meetings.
Okay, Chair. So just for clarity, so there's no truth in the rumour that taxi owners have been selling licences to other taxi companies then?
That's a commercial transaction between the two.
But are they allowed to if they don't own them in the first place?
I don't think that this is an isolated policy. There are policies up and down the country where there are restrictions. There are policies in place to allow a transfer.
Okay, we're going to the recommendations.
I would just like some...
Sorry, we're going to the recommendations. Sorry? Yeah, I know, in November. Sorry? Oh, yeah. Yeah, the two separate recommendations. It's just saying and 2 point. Yeah, that's. Yeah, we're talking semicolons here, so I'm no. Okay, do you want to read it there?
So the recommendation is that as of 30th November 2017, the present policy relating to transfer of Dumfries Zone taxi operators' licences as described there shall be withdrawn. Okay, all happy with that? Okay.
Thank you. And then we can agree the second part, 2.2. Agree 2.2. Yep. Okay. We want item 17, reports us to consider bringing provision of taxi and private hire vehicle inspections under the Civic Government Act 1982 in-house. The report identifies the considerations for a committee in this matter and the advantages of the Trade and Licensing Authority in doing so. The report does highlight the view of the licensing panel on this matter at paragraph 1.3, and Willie is here to answer any questions. Members? Jane?
Yes, I do. How does this support our local small and medium enterprises? That's only one question. I've got various questions, actually, about this. I think that also this is a change in policy. It is a change in policy. I'm really quite surprised that we don't need an impact assessment, or indeed it was not considered necessary to consult. So I'm a bit confused about all of this.
Okay, Jane, I'll just let come in and change the policy.
Just to clarify, it's not a change in policy. It's a change in the process by which we choose to have this work done, but it's not a policy. As such, so no impact assessment would be required.
Jane?
Okay, change in process.
but I presume it will have an effect on other people. I do see that, I didn't actually completely understand that we do appear to have asked for opinions, but then we say we're not consulting. So I think the whole thing is really rather strange. In addition to which, I think it's very strange that we say that that there is no possibility, this is on 3.9, that there is no possibility of perception of commercial interest. I mean, I thought we are trying to be enterprising, and you can't be enterprising if there isn't some indication that this is actually a commercial and value for money for the public sort of enterprise, which means presumably it will be cost-driven as well as quality-driven. So there will be. It is commercial. It's quite wrong to say it's not commercial.
I think the feedback I've had and all can be corrected on that, the operators are happy, the stakeholders are happy with this. But I'll be corrected if I'm wrong. That's the information I've got. And there's 19 other councils in Scotland that are doing the same system. Sorry, we've got Tom then, John.
Thanks, Chairman. We did go out to consultation with the tax operators, and indeed I was the only member of the panel that attended the meeting in Dumfries and the meeting in Shinrar. And one thing that came through loud and clear from the taxi and private hire operators was they would welcome this. Because this has been recorded, I didn't want to get into too much detail, but let me say it's something the trade would welcome as well. So I think if the trade are looking for it, and we're going to be an enterprising council, I see nothing wrong with going ahead with it.
Jill?
Thank you. Just a couple of questions. How much does it cost to do a check? I'm just asking, can somebody give me an idea of cost for the check?
That's actually part of our contract at the moment. So I wouldn't feel comfortable advising in a public forum.
Oh.
The one about how much is the council presently charged is part of a commercial contract. But if there's governance advice to the contrary, then...
We could probably send that to individual members or...
I'm sorry, but my point being that taxis have to be checked every 6 months. And if the figures on here tell me how many taxis there are, vehicle inspections, that works out at 1,896 vehicle inspections per 12-month period, I think. I'm not sure, but I think. And there must be a cost implication to that. So if there's a cost implication to that, which obviously there is, that means that's the amount of business that we are, as a council, are taking away from small businesses that carry out that at the moment. Now, I understand that the taxi operators might be quite happy for that to come to the council, and I'm not saying that that is wrong in any shape or form, but we have to understand that we've got policies in place as a council to look after small to medium-sized businesses in our own area. So I'm only trying to get a feel for how much business are we taking away and what benefit is that going to be to the council, because there's got to be a benefit. So I just think without the figures, I'm not sure how I can make a decision. I'm not trying to be difficult, I'm just trying to be realistic.
I'm in a difficult situation here, and that I've got the head of enterprise and DG whispering in my ear every 5 minutes. I'm just wondering whether Ronnie could address the panel. Sorry, address the committee.
I don't want you to give any commercially sensitive information in an open forum that's been recorded. I think that wouldn't be right, but...
Roy.
Thank you, Leader. Obviously, Enterprise and DG was approached to consider whether we had the capacity and the ability to deliver this service, if so wished by our council. Looking across Scotland with best practice, the local authorities that do participate in taxi testing, there are certainly a huge amount of benefits to be gained, and a lot of them are detailed within 3.9. Particularly a couple that I would like to highlight to members in relation to the increased enforcement and the ability to improve internal communication with the licensing side in relation to taxi. The testing process has no commercial entity. There is a cost, and if the decision of this committee was for us to carry that work out, then we would have a cost that would be reported to the licensing, which would be certainly no more than current charges. The purpose is that to ensure consistency of approach and to ensure that the license is done and checked for our council, and that is the primary process. And picking up on another comment in relation to supporting small to medium enterprises, we already do that with garages. There are, from our both council business and from our other trading operations, we support garages by feeding work activity to them as part of the overall commercial development plan within Enterprise and DG.
Yep.
I'm sorry, I absolutely get that. I get what you're saying, but it's just to try and work out the figures before I can make a decision, because at the front of our papers we have obviously that we are supposed to support small business. And I get what you're saying. I'm just trying to figure out how much it is. And it is a cost to the council. So therefore, if it's a cost to the council and that's not being passed on, that is a free service to the taxi operators, because they currently have to pay for that. So are they paying the council for that? Okay, I still need to know. I can't make a decision without knowing.
Rob.
Thanks, Leader. Daft laddie question. I assume that I'm right in thinking that this would give effect to the council doing the tests, but we wouldn't be thereafter undertaking any work that was required on vehicles that was recommended as a result of the test. I mean, that would effectively still go to whatever businesses already had arrangements over the years. Am I right in thinking that?
Through you, Leader. Absolutely. We would provide a detailed report to any taxi operator if there was any defects or repairs required. It would be entirely up to themselves whether they went to their own supplier, their own garages, to have that work carried out. But if they so wish to approach the council, then the council would consider that as well.
Andy.
Thanks very much. One thing for me that's kind of covered a wee bit in the report but undersells it is if you're under the current process just now, and if you're a taxi operator and you've had your vehicle in and you're unhappy or you think that you've been treated unfairly or whatever, there is no real complaints process. If we bring it back in-house, that then is an assurance for the people that if they consider they've not been treated fairly, there is a council process that ensures that they do get treated fairly, and there is a mechanism for them to register complaints, register concerns, and if for nothing else, that for me is the massive, massive sell for this. Because at the end of the day, not everything should be for profit, not everything should be what it is. Sometimes we provide a public service here to ensure that the public feel they've been treated fairly and are treated fairly, and that's for me that would have come out of this.
I think that's partly, you know, that why the operators are happy, because there's a consistency within that. We've got Jim McComb, is it? No, Jim McClung, sorry.
That's the problem when you've got folk with the same initials. Back to the points of the 3.9, the first bullet point and the second bullet point make it absolutely clear to me that members of the trade, rightly or wrongly, have a view that there's inconsistencies in the way that the tests are being carried out at the minute. Bringing it into the council, or rather, as Councillor Davison said, bringing it back into the council, Because when this first started, it was council employees, council mechanics, that did the tests. They also worked with the Police Scotland, or as they were then, Dumfries and Galloway Constabulary, to carry out spot checks on the road, on taxis. I can have some sympathy with Councillor Dykes in supporting small business, taxi operators or small businesses as well. If they feel they are not being treated fairly, and we have the opportunity to make sure that they are being treated fairly, I'm quite happy to go along with the recommendations of the report, and that the testing of taxis is brought back into the council. I may have been under the wrong impression, but there was a kind of intake of breath when Councillor Davison asked his question about the council not carrying out repairs. The test that is carried out for taxi licences and private hire licences, for that matter, are far more stringent than what it is actually for a vehicle on the road. You may not get a taxi plate, but your vehicle would still be legal for the road, so you can take it out and take it anywhere you want to go to repair it. There is no need for it to be repaired straight away, as long as it's not a defect that makes it unsuitable for the road. But taxi licences, private hire licences, have a far more stringent test than what it is for an MOT, or whether it's safe to be on the road as a private car.
Okay, we've got Tom.
Yeah, I mean, I've got to agree with that point that Jim made there. I would reiterate, it's something that the taxi operators and private hire operators wanted. And I think it could be reminded, how many garages actually undertake the tests at the moment? Three. But how many garage owners? Two. So you're talking two garage owners, one of who's a multinational company. So, you know, I think we should listen to some of the smaller businesses in the area and support them.
Right. I've got Patsy, or perhaps before I bring Patsy in, maybe would it be possible if we broke for lunch and maybe get some of the information that John wants within that period of time? Would that help?
I'm happy with that. I'm asking for some information before I can make a decision. I don't think that's wrong, and I don't feel I should be bullied into making a decision by other members in this chamber because they feel I'm asking for information that's not correct.
I mean, if that information is available and people can, and as long as it's exempt, the information would be exempt. Members, lunch. And then we can get that information. I have the information in front of you, and it's a reminder that that's exempt information. I was going to ask Patsy because she wanted in, but John.
Thank you, Leader. Can I just ask? Then I'm presuming that the council will be charging similar cost, and that it will be for inspection only, so taxi and private hire vehicle inspection in-house only for that purpose. And if there was to be any suggestion that we would do any additional work, then that, in my opinion, should be something that should come back to committee for discussion and agreement. And if that is the case, I'm happy.
I think what happens now, I think it was explained that, you know, when they've done the test, that's not a decision that we can make on a taxi operator to say where they'll go. They have the choice, and if they want the choice to DG Enterprise, then they can use DG Enterprise just like anybody else, like I can. I can go to DG Enterprise. Jeff?
The situation is exactly the same with an MOT test. You have to have the MOT test at an MOT testing station. It's then up to you whether you have the work done. If the car is such that it's deemed to be dangerous, then you can take it away, but that's at your own risk. But you would normally have to be recovered to a different garage, so there's no difference.
Stephen.
Thanks, Leader. Just looking at this additional information, obviously there's a number of operators which will require annual testing. So that's a kind of known amount. I'm just sort of trying to get a sense of, clearly this isn't requiring, or is it requiring any additional investment in our equipment or staff in order to carry out this specific piece of work? Will it take them from existing areas of work? How has that been factored in, and do we have to offset that with additional recruitment or overtime, or how does that work? Have we got equipment or staff that aren't being fully utilised that can take on this work?
I suppose that'll be for the enterprising committee to make that decision. It's not up to this policy resources.
Yep. It's really just a question on, is that something we need to consider? Obviously, we have the lead officers present here who would be at Enterprising Committee anyway, so I'm just wondering, can we ask the question? I'm not asking for a determination, it's really just to find out information.
Through you, Leader, yes, we can deliver the service that the Council would require in relation to the taxi testing from the two identified sites that we've propose in Stranraer and in Dumfries to deliver what is required by the taxi licensing service.
Okay, we've got Jane.
I'm glad we've had this discussion because, in fact, if you look at the recommendation, a member of the public looking at that would say, oh, well, that's fine. Enterprising D&G's proposal is to provide taxi and private hire vehicle inspections in-house. And that's what it says. But what you're suggesting, Leader, is that this committee should accept that following on as a natural progression from inspections, of course, will be work. The public doesn't know that. No, the garage and anybody else involved, the garage fraternity out there don't know that. They assume that we are giving permission simply to do inspections. And as I say, one of the things we are supposed to be doing is supporting SMEs. And I fail to understand how this actually supports SMEs. It's quite different when you have a framework where we are chunking up big contracts and making certain that local companies can do them. That's great. But to pick away at little bits of business that can be done by our local SMEs on the back of tests, which we have not told the public about, but which I'm glad has come out into the public here, is quite different. So I would suggest that Councillor Dykes has got it absolutely right, that we have another report back to find out what exactly is being done and on the back of these tests, because otherwise it's extremely slippery. I'm sure you can understand that.
This is not about doing any additional work. This is my understanding. It is not about doing any additional work. As I've said, it's always been the case. I mean, I could go to DG Enterprise. I could ask for a piece of work to be done rather than go somewhere else. And nothing has changed. Nothing has changed. If we give permission for this, this is for the vehicle inspections. If the operator then wants to ask DG first to do any extra work, that's their prerogative. It's not up to you or me to say to the operator, no, you can't. They have that right just now, and it's just a continuation of that. Patsy.
Thank you. It's about, you say, I've just heard you say that we have two centres for doing these inspections, one in Stranraer and one in Dumfries. So where in the past have the taxis in the Stewartry area and Annadale and Esdale been having their taxis checked?
Within the Stewartry, they go to Dumfries, and we do have a station at Lockerbie presently that undertakes them. But I understand that Ronnie did speak to operators within Annadale and Esdale, and the attitude was there wasn't an issue going to Dumfries.
But if you're a taxi driver in Langham, you're now going to have to come all the way to Dumfries to, rather than going down to Lockerbie to have a test. And if you don't pass the test, you're going to be offered to have your car sorted in Dumfries.
Mm-hmm. Anyway, right, Ted.
I think there are many advantages of bringing this service in-house, and they're contained in 3.9, so I don't propose to list them all there for everyone to see. I think the matter that's been brought up regarding who does repairs on vehicles is entirely up to the individual to decide where that actually happens. We've had a good deal of discussion about this, and I would actually move that we go to the recommendations as contained in 2.
Okay, I'm going to the recommendations. Can we agree the recommendations? Jane?
I would like to propose that we agree the recommendations as they are and receive a report to this committee on the number of follow-up repairs which have taken place as a result of testing.
No, that's Andy.
I would suggest if there's any performance reports will go back to the respective service committee, not back to here. Yeah. So that'll all be part of the deal, I would have thought that should be a given. It doesn't have to be built into a recommendation here, it's part of our governance in the council.
Jim?
Yeah, I was merely going to say that if the operators want DG Enterprise to actually undertake it, that is an enterprising part of the enterprising council. It will go back to the enterprising subcommittee for the report on how much work they're doing and how much they're earning.
Can we agree the recommendation? Okay. Jane?
I was quite prepared to have the report go back to the enterprising sub. I would propose that as an amendment.
Of course, it's their business, so it'll be, performance reporting.
Chair, could we just have that confirmed? And I think if that's confirmed by the officer, I'm happy with that.
Performance.
Sorry, Leader. Yes, as detailed within the report, vehicle, as it says in 3.9, reporting vehicle test failures and adverse incidents would be reported back to the licensing manager, so there is a full and robust and transparent awareness of the state of the taxis that are on the roads within Dumfries and Galloway.
But the enterprising part of it would go back, be reported to that committee?
Yes, Chair.
Yep. Thank you. Okay. Item 18, this report presents options to deliver the outcomes of the service review on administration and support and seeks members' approval for a recommended option. This review is one of the programme of service reviews we agreed and follows an extensive exercise using the Council's agreed service review approach. This committee agreed the scope and outcomes of the review on 22nd of September 2015, and this report provides a comprehensive consideration and evidence in relation to delivering those outcomes and the preferred way forward from the review team to deliver these. Paul and James is here to answer any question. Members? Andy?
Thanks very much. Again, it's a massive piece of work, and credit to the officers for taking this forward. The one bit I've got, it's no a worry about per se, it's an omission here. It's the impact assessment, and if it's been done, what's the outcome of the impact assessment? It's saying here it can be provided and requested. I would have thought it should have been in the right, embedded in the middle of the report. So I'm acutely aware the vast majority of staff that this is referring to are low-paid female part-time workers, And I'm just worried about them being put to detriment. We've been here before in 2009 with single status. I wouldn't like to go back there again, because we kind of demonstrate the impact assessment and just exactly what the outcome of that was.
Yeah, through yourself, leader. Yeah, impact assessment has been completed, and I can follow that on to you after the meeting. If that's the best way forward.
Thanks, Jamie. I appreciate that. When was that completed, or could it not have been put in the papers, or is it something that's happened fairly recently? Has there been ongoing work or something like that?
No, it was completed back in September, so it's something that could have been put in the report.
Okay. Got any recommendations? Reviewed, one, can agree two, and no, and agree three.
Can we also have it minuted that we're members are going to be given a copy of the impact assessment?
Yep. Okay, will you make that happen? Okay. Thanks. Okay, item 19, service review charging for services. The report presents options to deliver the outcomes of the service review and charging for services and seeks members' approval for implementation and follows an exercise using the Council's agreed service review approach. This committee agreed the scope and outcomes of this review on the 17th of November 2015, and this report proposes a preferred way forward. Donna and Ronnie are here to speak to the report. I will open up the meeting to members. Andy?
Thanks very much. I wouldn't even like to dream of going into all the different plethora of charges and how we're doing it and differences, you know, right across a huge number of pages here. But I think what I think we should be looking for here is some sort of assurance of how confident are the review team that we'll have all the unit costs for every fee available in time for the next business plan time. I think on the surface, and there might be a very valid reason for it, I'm really pleased I'm a retired council officer, because I wouldn't like to try and reconcile some of these charges and try to balance a till at the end of a night if there was something out and you're working with a till system that's computerised, you're using a code. There just seems some huge anomalies right across the board, and I think that's the bit that's more worrying everyone. It's how do we get this round? How do we actually, when it comes to budget setting time, look at what the income streams are for these departments? And taking one example, I think there's about 7 or 8 different charges for football pitches, just as an example. So how can we rationalise that? How can we actually get it in? Or where are we with that work? I think maybe is a better question.
I think on an overall basis as well, you know, it's not really clear what members can expect in the new year if they agree this report. Is the assumption that members will, you know, will we have to present in their budget proposals details to the value of every charge we make?
Excuse me, there's work ongoing by officers at the moment to prepare information for members in January that will align to the budget proposal, the budget consideration process. What officers are doing just now is working that information up using information that's already in the ABB. There's an amount of information there that already has some of the costs there. It's not across the piece. So some of the work's already done just by the normal course of business, and where their gaps are, we've already got officers working there. So the information that we would have coming to members in January is using the framework that is within here, and using the cost model that's within that, that will bring a level of detail for some of the services that we've not had to date, but are already there within others. So we're fairly confident that what you'll be getting in January
is completed templates that will bring a kind of shopping list of where you can make savings that will match up to the 900,000 target that was set for this review.
So the second part of that is that, you know, that as part of the agreed budget process, we, to make a savings of £900,000. But rather than coming back to policy resources, it's being done as part of the budget process. Is that what you're saying?
Yes, that's the proposal on the table.
So, yep. That was a kind of question, that why is it being done as part of the budget rather than simply come back to policy resources when we've actually made the decision for the £900,000? And what you're saying is that it's coming back for a lucky dip, a pick and choose, you know.
I think it's coming back because what we were conscious of was that we would potentially be bringing something back here. There's a budget process ongoing and there's the potential for double counting, confusion there, and we thought it streamlined the process into one where the target's there and it will be given to you for consideration as that in that way.
I think that was what the Business Transformation Board came back with, that kind of.
Yes, that was the recommendation from the BTSG at the end of October.
Right. Okay, members. Rob. Oh, sorry, it's Tom first.
Can I say that this went to the Business Transformation Steering Group. We did say to officers that you've got to recognise the three different types of charges. You've got charges that are set by the Scottish Government over which we've no control. For instance, planning fees, that's out with our control. But there's charges within our control that are determined by the Open Government Act of the 1980s, where we are duty bound to recover at least the cost of administering those services, and that's the things like taxi licensing, etc. What we've tended to do with that, because these were all district council functions, when all the councils merged, we just came up with one figure that kind of covered the four areas, and that's basically been increased by inflation or not increased every year. So that one needs to be examined to ensure we're at least getting back the cost to recover it to comply with the law. And then just about every other charge is at the whim of the council, whether it's school meals or charges to enter a swimming pool or whatever. So there's the three different styles there. Two are certainly covered by statute and one is at our own whim. So that's what officers have basically got to work with.
I think that, you know, that it is just quite a, you know, an in-depth paper in there. And what you've got is you've got the, you know, the £18 million for fees and charges, statutory and non-statutory. You've got the external trading, which is £10 million, and you've got the IGB, which is 15. But you don't take out the IGB and you take out the external trading. And within the £18 million, you've got statutory and non-statutory. So it's the non-statutory within the £18 million that's the fees and charges that we're actually working with.
In the main, yes. However, within the ones that are statutory, we're doing a double check to ensure that they, as Councillor McCaughtry said, that there are opportunities to ensure that we are recovering what we can. When we say full cost recovery, different services have been using a different interpretation of what that is. Some of it's been purely on staff time. Others are using heating, lighting, rental, etc. So we're asking officers to do a double check on that to ensure that they are in line and that we are optimising the return there as well. We also think some of the statutory charges that we are, that while we cannot impact on what we charge for those, that there is scope to make savings in how we provide those, and we're asking officers to look at those too. So while it's predominantly about the discretionary charges, we believe that there are opportunities to identify either savings or income generation opportunities within the others as well.
And I suppose we discussed it earlier regarding the EEI and the charges that they make. It all depends what comes back from the Scottish Government, which I believe is positive, you know, that we've got to have more flexibility in the way we charge for some fees. And that's, you know, whereas just now we don't make the cost of it back. Andy?
Thanks, Leader. I see that the income from the trading arm is out with the scope of the review. I'm assuming there'll be some sort of similar exercise looking at how the trading arm actually conduct their support business, or is there a resource transfer from the trading arm across to the main service area to, you know, for the cost of admin staff, for example, and things like that are covered in this review. So how are we dealing with that, given that there's a significant transfer and say money back and forward, albeit internal, the vast majority. It's a paper exercise, yeah, but how do we balance that out to make sure that the proper resource transfer is taking place and the proper use or the proper payment from the profits of the Enterprising Council are used towards the cost of the support they're getting? Or are we just top slicing it? What are we doing?
Through you, Chair. We have conducted a very similar process as part of the development of the Enterprising Service Commercial Development Plan, which is clearly detailed projected income growth over the coming years. So we've built all these models in relation to the support charges, etc., into that to give us a return. So that has been reported as part of that development process within both the EI committee and to the Enterprising Subcommittee.
Okay, can we go to the recommendations? Right, Stephen.
Thank you. Just on the back of the comment there about what is a required fee, will that be listed? Because obviously the list of Appendix 2, for example, it doesn't actually say, you know, is this something that we can just vary on a sliding scale, or is it a statutory fee within the scope of the actual piece of work? And I'm just wondering, it might be helpful for members to know that, oh, well, actually that's statutory, and which, you know, so it's not actually in there at the moment. And I do notice that the enterprise and services does have the kind of services there where they do list a charge. Obviously, I presume that's the part that's within scope as opposed to the part that's been excluded.
Yes, we can provide that detail. We haven't laid it out here, but yes, we can provide the detail. We do have the detail of what is discretionary and where the charges sit. And you're right, in terms of the what's within the enterprise and services, it's where there is a standard charge there.
So on the back of that, I presume the 900k income generated is out. So this is additional to the 900k. This is actually for enterprise and services. This is not to be confused with the 900k target, as it were, we're sort of setting for an income in terms of the charges that we make.
Enterprise and services have got income targets within that have been agreed at DEI committee in relation to the commercial development plan. So that is separate to these elements sitting here.
Okay, good recommendations. Can we've considered, can we agree 2, 2 and 2, 3? Okay. Okay. Okay, moving on to item 20. This is the former Johnson Primary School proposed community asset transfer. The report asks members to consider the transfer of the former Johnson Primary School to Kirkcudbright Development Trust. The report presents us with a range of options and how we may consider proceeding. The request for a community asset transfer is a less than best consideration, and officers have provided an assessment of the requirements for that and offer made. Louise is here to answer any questions. Could you just clarify? I don't know if I can ask this or not, because it's a figure out in the public. There's a £30,000 figure that's out in the public. That the Trust have received since, and this is not funding that can be used for capital. It's to develop the project.
Yes, Chair. Throughout the last few months, the Development Trust have kept officers abreast of the various funding applications they've been making and the conversations they've been having, what successes they've had so far in that regard. And they have recently advised that they've been awarded £30,000 development funding. Our understanding is that that is towards the development of the project rather than towards the capital cost. That's officers' understanding of the funding that they've recently received.
Members? Tom?
View what's been said, be consistent and move option two as we did at the area committee last week.
Rob?
Chairman, very briefly, just happy to second that. I mean, the money is starting to come in. The people who are involved have a significant track record with other big projects. I think that this one will come together and it will be a good asset to the community in due course.
Right, so option two gives a certain date. Can we agree that a community asset transfer be made to the Trust for a nominal sum with the condition that the required capital funding for the project is secured by a suggested date, and the suggested date is the 30th of September 2017? Therefore, it remains unchanged.
It's the date I'm kind of worried about. I mean, what happens if someone comes in the 1st of October? Right, you follow me? It's really prescriptive. I agree with Tom. We need to move this forward, give them all the backing we can. But is there some way there could be a bit of leeway if we're talking a week or a fortnight or something like that before it can get concluded? If we're so prescriptive in this, there's a danger it could actually...
I think the danger is by not applying a date, it runs a risk of the property remaining empty for forever more. So a week can turn into a month, can turn into a year. Okay, do what you...
Thanks, Chair. I would suggest that officers are going to be keeping quite a close eye on the development of this, the funding that's coming in, and that if it appears that, you know, they're going to be very, you know, getting that money just beyond the deadline that's been set, then we can certainly come back to report on that, because it would seem unreasonable if it was a matter of days to just put the shutters down.
Yeah, really, that the answer was covered what I was going to say. It's a case of that we give them to the 30th of September with a bit of leeway, but in any case, what happens to the building then, if they haven't been successful, we'll have to come back here in any case. Is that right?
Can we agree that? Note the 2-1, we've considered 2-2. We have agreed option, which is option 2 with that, the date. And we've agreed 2.4. That's it. Okay. Item 21, this report seeks members' agreement to the sale and lease of land at Hamilton Stark Park to Queer to Scottish Water for the purpose of upgrading the existing wastewater pumping station. Recommendations from the Nisdale Area Committee are set out in paragraph 3.9 of this report, and Louise is here to answer any questions. Members? Tom?
Well, I believe that they withdrew that original planning application and come back in with another one, so how does that materially affect the recommendations here?
Do you want to go through the chronology?
Thanks, Chair. As Councillor McCautry has indicated, the planning application was withdrawn by Scottish Water last week, but we understand that they immediately resubmitted an application for a larger area of ground. We received notification as the landowners on the 21st, and also on the 21st, but just yesterday, they wrote to us to request use of a further area of ground, which extends to just about 5,330 square metres for a period of 6 weeks towards the end of the construction period of the works. That area of ground would remain in the council's ownership. They're not seeking to acquire it. If members look at Appendix 1, and they'll see that there's a north point indicated on that drawing, triangular area of land, if one imagines that that was mirrored towards the east, that gives an indication of the additional area of ground that they're seeking. The reason that they're looking for this additional area of ground is to enable them to construct a compensatory storage area in order to comply with SEPA's requirements in relation to possible flooding of this area, which is right next to the river, and the whole site is in a flood risk zone. We've agreed with Scottish Water that they would pay £750 per week for the use of the land during that period, and that money would also go to the Common Good Fund. The use of that land would be for approximately 6 weeks. It would then continue as open ground after that time. I would suggest, Chair, that an additional recommendation could be added stating that the committee agrees that a further area of ground to the east of the areas indicated on Appendix 1 and extending to 5,330 square metres or thereby be leased to Scottish Water for the sum of £750 per week, and that the monies arising therefore be credited to, arising therefrom be credited to the Dumfries Common Good Fund.
Can we agree? Okay, item 22, no urgent business. Moving on to item 23, which is, do we agree to adopt a resolution to exclude the public from the meeting in terms of section 50A4 of and paragraph 6 of part 1 of schedule 7A to the Local Government Scotland Act 1973. Notice how I memorised that.